You're on Meet the Press. The three-week blockade of Grocon building sites may be over, but the construction union's tactics have ignited new debate over Labor's dismantling of the Howard government's tough regulator, the Australian Building and Construction Commission. And it's welcome back to the program, the ACTU's Dave Oliver. Good morning, Mr. Oliver.
Good morning.
Wasn't it a bad look? Didn't it remind people of the confrontational days of the BLF? And didn't it do the union movement a bad favour?
Well, I think you're right. The context of the confrontational nature of the dispute, clearly what was needed in this particular dispute was to be able to have an independent arbitrator get in there with the powers to resolve it. And that way the dispute wouldn't have prolonged to the extent that it did. And this is the problem that we're seeing now. I mean, we've got talk now that this dispute's going to be prolonged long after the issues have been resolved. We've got one company out there saying that they're going to sue the unions. And we can't see what's the point of prolonging these, you know, this dispute long after the issues are going to be resolved.
But hasn't Grocon got this in its favour? The court found that the blockade was illegal, and there was an ability for the employer and indeed even the state government to sue for damages.
Yeah, well, the state government knows themselves there's no advantage in trying to sue parties to a dispute long after they're over, because if that was the case, Ted Bayou would be out there suing nurses at the moment. I mean, every dispute has an end. During the lineup of the, trying to resolve the issues, there's various activities that are taken in the court, but the ultimate resolution is to resolve it. We don't see any point. Why do you want to continue it long after the dispute's been resolved?
Mr. Oliver, Ted Bailey has actually said this week that he wants to lock the CFMEU out of future infrastructure projects. Are you going to contest that?
Well, what Ted Bailey should be more worried about is trying to get more infrastructure projects happening in this country. We see that there's now a declining amount of construction work happening here in Victoria. We've seen the amount of infrastructure work on the decline. So he should be focusing more on how to get more work here than rather trying to play some political game about, taking on the unions in this state.
But at the same time, I mean, you must be embarrassed by the action of the CFMEU in terms of the optics of this. I mean, it's certainly made your argument for workplace reform more difficult, hasn't it?
No, let's look at the optics of it. I mean, what we had here was a group of workers that were protesting over legitimate safety issues. I mean, the construction industry isn't a safe industry. I mean, I worked in it for many years. I've lost workmates. My son works in the industry. And all over this country, there's hundreds of thousands, mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, sons and daughters who want to make sure that people that work in the construction industry come home in one piece. And, it didn't do anyone any good with the Premier wanting to send the horses in to break up the peaceful protest that was happening. That's where we got, the colourful scenes. And, in fact, it was, fanning flames.
But is safety being used as a Trojan horse here? The union says it wants safety officers. They already exist there. They've been elected. The company says that there's bad form here, that these officers are really in there to provoke the workers.
Well, where's the evidence? I mean, what lied at the heart of the dispute was the right to have the best qualified safety personnel on the job to monitor health and safety. My understanding is the current safety rep on the job is someone that hasn't worked in the industry before. Another one is the son of the senior HR manager. So there is obviously concern about having the right to have the best possible safety reps on the project.
How about those workers that put their names to that letter that was published in the newspapers this week, saying, we pay our union dues, why do we have to suffer from the, actions from our union leadership? Do you have any sympathy for those workers?
Oh, there's going to be lots of views regarding people in this dispute, either direct employees or contractors that have been affected. But what we should be focusing on now is getting a resolution to the dispute. And quite simply, what we would like to see is for the parties to get around the table. Because the other dimension we've seen in industrial relations in this country now is it's moved away from the industrial practitioners with an empowered, independent umpire to now where we contract it out to the lawyers. And where's the vested interest in this?
I mean, you think the Fair Work laws have failed? That's what, in this case?
Oh, I think they can be improved in giving more power to the independent umpire, because there is a lot of vested interest in this. This dispute could have been resolved a week earlier than it was if Daniel Grollo had decided to pick up the recommendation from Fair Work Australia. But what happens is you've got lawyers in here that are getting paid thousands of dollars on the hour that are lining up, and it is in their interest to prolong these disputes. They don't get resolved in the courts, they'll get resolved around the table.
Mr. Oliver, could I take you to another issue? There's been two significant changes to the carbon tax since it's been introduced, both of which the union support, you support yourself. What other changes do you want to see to the carbon tax before you're comfortable that manufacturers particularly will survive under this new regime?
Well, I mean, we've always been comfortable with the general direction because we know that the government got the policy mix right, particularly in respect to the compensation issue.
But you said that when it was introduced, and there's been two changes since that. Now you're saying you like it more now than after the two changes.
Oh, no.
What other changes do you want to see?
No. The aspect that hasn't been changed that we see is the critical part of taking us forward is the capacity of building a clean tech industry in this country with the amount of money that's being set aside with the Clean Energy Finance Corporation and to assist the innovators in this country to be able to get their ideas off the drawing board into the workplaces around this country.
So what about the $23 price? Are you still comfortable with that?
Yeah, we are comfortable with that.
And what other changes would you like to see around the edges?
Well, at the moment, again, we just want to make sure that the opportunities that are going to be there for manufacturers and to build the clean tech industry in this country are going to be there, and that's what we'll be focused on in our discussions, with the government looking forward about how those opportunities are going to be there, utilising the funds that have been put aside.
Thank you very much for being with us today, Dave Oliver. And thanks to our panel, Simon Benson and Patricia Cavellis. A transcript and a replay of this program will be on our website and Facebook page. Until next week, goodbye.